Hey folks, so I'm going to do a video on tools. I have been asked, most specifically by Nigel Wells, if I would do a video on, well, I guess specific tools, like specialized tools. And I've done tool videos before, but it was a long time ago. Actually, I went back and looked at them, and they're really old and outdated and kind of shit. So and they're kind of out of context now, so they're not really useful. They make reference to videos that I don't have on YouTube anymore, and so they're kind of useless. So I figured I'm just gonna film a new one. So I'm hoping I won't make this a long one if I decide that it's not gonna work to make it a short video. I'll do two separate ones. So the first part that I'm going to talk about are basic tools. So by basic tools, I mean the few tools that anyone who's just getting started would need. They're very, very simple. This isn't one of them. This is my Acme Stick 2.0. Everybody should have one of these, right? You know, this is my second version of the stick. The first version didn't work out so well, so I had to come up with a new one. That's not one of the tools. So, this number one tool, a hobby knife. You could use like all kinds of different sharp things to do what this thing does, because mostly what you're doing is using it to clean up parts, reshape parts, and well, there's other little teeny things that you can do, like make holes and stuff like that, and some sculpting on figures and stuff like that. But the essential bareness of this thing is for cutting stuff. And like I said, there's a lot of different things that you can use to do that. However, the hobby knife or craft knife, like this very simple one, you can still buy these. In fact, they're very cheap, like $7 kind of thing. The blades aren't, right, just the handle, about $7. You know, you can get them on Amazon or eBay and stuff like that. They're really, really cheap. And the hobby version of these things are far superior than a steak knife or your pocket knife or, you know, a lawnmower blade or anything like that. The actual hobby-specific knife is better because it uses very specific, extremely sharp blades that are very good at doing what we need them to do. They're target-specific devices. And you tend to only use it for your hobby so it doesn't get broken or misused doing other things like picking locks or scratching your dog's ears or cutting wire and stuff like that. So this tool, very important, very useful, and highly recommended to get one. Now, comes all kinds of different shapes and sizes. You can get actual scalpels that a surgeon would use, and the scalpel blades that come with them. You can get different ones like this one here. This is also the same kind of thing. It's a bigger, heavier, chunkier version of the thing. I don't recommend this thing. This thing's a piece of shit. So if I was going to recommend one, you know, this one here, you can just type in hobby knife on Amazon and you'll see dozens of different things to pick from, right? You see one that looks like that? Can't go wrong. Pretty simple tool. You loosen the handle, take the blade out, put the blade in, tighten the handle. Very simple tool. The blades that you can put in there, there's all kinds of different blades you can put in there. The blade of choice that, now, not all, but a large number of hobbyists use is the number 11 blade, which is what that is. It's a specific shape that we've all kind of gotten used to. Now there's other modelers that have different preferences when it comes to blades, but the vast majority that I have seen using, and I've watched a lot of guys using these things, a lot of guys. I'm subscribed to probably around 1,500 YouTube channels. And I watch a lot of YouTube videos, and I see a lot of guys using the number 11 blade. So the number 11 blade is generally one that gets used in the most common. It's a comfortable and easy shape to work with. Now, I do not recommend buying X-Acto. X-Acto is a brand name that makes the number 11 blade. I recommend buying cheap knockoff ones that cost a tenth of the price. Hobby Zone. There's a company that went out of business there not long ago. I don't remember what it's called. Big modeling company. They used to make hobby knives. You used to be able to get them in packs of 100 for 10 bucks. They're gone now. So, anyway, and you know, you get them in a box, and a little paper box. That was the name of that company. Went out of business last year or the year before. Ah, shit. That's right on the tip of my tongue. Hobby Co. That's it. Hobby Co. Used to sell number 11 blades in the dozens, and you could buy them really cheap. But, you know, like these ones here, Hobby Blades, Alloy, Tool, Steel, number 11, 120 pack. That cost me $10 on Amazon. All right. They're just as good as any X-Acto knife. You know, they're really not much of a difference. Sometimes the tips break, but that does, the X-Acto knives do the same thing. So don't waste your money on X-Acto blades. X-Acto blades, you get five or seven blades for like $10. Why would you do that when you can get 120 for the same price? It's freaking stupid. So don't buy X-Acto blades. Buy the cheap knockoff ones. They're just as good. You can get hobby blades in huge assortment of shapes. Like, I have quite a number. I almost never use these. I have them because they came in different sets and stuff like that, but I never use them. So, if you get a big fancy hobby knife set, those things come with them, so, you know, you can get them with that. But they're not really necessary, right? So that's number one tool, right? Next tool that you'll need, tweezers, right? Good tweezers. These are not good tweezers. I don't know why I grabbed that. Probably because it was on top. These are good tweezers. I have, where are they? They're there. Two. I'll recommend. So we have these ones. These are the Tamiya brand name ones. They're excellent tweezers, extremely strong, very nice bind. When they come together nice and tight. They're pretty strong in the tip, so they don't deform. These ones are the wide ones. I also have the narrow ones. They're like just like these, but they're made by Tamiya. They have nice springiness, they're comfortable, they're lightweight, but they still have enough heft in them there. They give you control because the weight gives you a little bit of control. So they're excellent tools, and I highly recommend these Tamiya tweezers. There is one downside to them. They're not demagnetized. If you're using any kind of magnetic, like steel wire or anything like that, they will pick it up and it will stick to the tip of your tweezers, and it's really annoying. These, however, I don't even know what brand name they are, other than the fact it has GG written on the side here. That's the only thing I've ever found about them. Are not magnetized. So I use these for dealing with steel parts and stuff like that because they're not magnetized. And they're also, you know, sharp tip point, right? These are also good quality tweezers. They're not as thick or robust as the Tamiya. They're not as good quality as the Tamiya, but the benefit is they're not magnetized. So, but good quality tweezers, not shit cheapo tweezers like these pieces of garbage that bend and they're squash. You squeeze them too tight and they deform and you never get them back together again properly. These things are junk. I do not recommend those. These things are expensive too, right? I came with a set of, there's like 15 or 20 tweezers in it for like $35. Waste freaking money. Don't recommend them. I use these now for dioramas. I don't use them for actually working on models. So a good pair of tweezers and a hobby knife. These are things that you really, really need when you first start out. Another thing you're going to need sanding sticks. Very, very useful tools. These things are good for cleaning up parts, reshaping parts, fixing errors in fits and stuff like that. A couple of different grits. There are hobby specific ones that are mostly bullshit products because they're just rebranded nail files or nail sanders that they've either cut to a different shape to suit their needs or maybe added a different backing to them to make them a little softer or a little harder. Really unnecessary features, right? The regular nail buffing kinds, I bought huge numbers of them. I'll show you this. That was $15 worth. Most of these black ones there. And more of them in there. That's like $15 worth of sanders. So I don't recommend buying the hobby specific ones at all. I see that as an enormous waste of money. But you know, a fool and their money are soon parted. It's usually the rule. You can get the same effect and the same use out of the nail sanding ones. And they're really easy to find. You just go on Amazon or go on eBay. If you want to use AliExpress, you can buy them there. But yeah, they come in all the grits that you need in order to do the job. And they're very, very cheap. A lot of them even come with free shipping. So sanding sticks are very, very useful things to have. Now, some people say this is not a necessary tool. Other people say it is. I'm one of the ones that say that it's probably a necessary tool. Jeweler's files. I would strongly recommend getting yourself a cheap set of jeweler's files. You do not need to spend an enormous amount of money on jeweler's files. $7 at your local hardware store. You can get the fancy ones with the rubber handles. You can get the ones without them. It doesn't make any difference. All of these used to have rubber handles, but I took the rubber handles off because I found them annoying. So you can do whatever you want with them. But jeweler's files are extremely useful for doing all kinds of different kinds of modeling, for cleaning up parts, parts that are more stubborn. You can't get off this one of these, or stuff that you need to do like battle damage or road wheel damage and stuff like that, or you're reshaping parts and stuff like that. A file is sometimes a lot more better of a choice than a sanding stick. They can also get into smaller spaces that sanding sticks can't get into, even if you have thinning sticks, like these little sticks, these little thin sanders, right? Even if you have these, they're these things here can get in there better because they're stiffer. You know, you'll actually get better purchase. So yes, jeweler's files are definitely another tool that I would highly recommend that you get. So tweezers, hobby knife, sanding sticks, jeweler's tool, or jeweler's file. These are very important things. Okay? Those are enough to get you started for building, but you need something to make everything stick together. You need glue. Now, I use Tamiya Extra Thin. It's the glue I've been using for years. There are other glues that have come out in the years since I started. Most of them are actually different versions of Tamiya Extra Thin, but they all pretty much do the same thing. They're hot glue. This type of glue specifically, and it's the range of glues that Tamiya Extra Thin falls within, they work on an effect called capillary action. You have two parts that come together, and you add a little tiny bit of glue to the crack, and the glue actually crawls into the crack and feeds all along inside and actually heats up the plastic, and it melts and then glues together like a weld. That's what this glue does. It is 100,000 times better than the old-fashioned tube glue that we used to get years ago, and you can still buy. I have some here somewhere. I don't know where it is. I don't use it anymore because it's messy, it stinks badly. I don't have a use for it anymore, so I use the Tamiya Extra Thin. There are lots of other glues out there, and I have some here. There's another one here. It's kind of a thicker version of Tamiya Extra Thin. All right, this stuff's actually really nice. There's another one with an orange bottle top. It's the same sort of stuff as this here, but it's has a slightly different chemical makeup. Can't remember what's in it now. Bugger, I can't remember now. I don't use it very often though. I have some because I wanted to use it to see, you know, how good it was or anything, but it really wasn't all that much different than that thick stuff there, so I don't use it very often. I have it, you know, but I don't use it very much. My go-to glue is the To Me Extra Thin for gluing plastic to plastic. So, you know, but there are other types of methyl ethyl ketone, MEK. I don't know if it's metal ethyl or methyl ethyl ketone. MEK is the active ingredient in this stuff. Don't use that, by the way. If you go to the hardware store and buy MEK to use on your models, I don't recommend doing that. You can use it. Yep. And then you can go to the doctor and ask him why you have tumors in your lungs and stuff because you've developed cancer. This stuff here is bad. MEK is this with hot sauce. Straight MEK is, that's bad stuff. You do not want to be using that in a, even in a well-ventilated room without a respirator. You're going to fuck yourself all to hell. I am not going to recommend MEK to anyone. You can go ahead and use it if you want, but I'm not going to recommend it. If you want to use it, that's your business, but I'm not going to say go ahead and do that. I had some, and I've tried it. It does the job, but it's toxic as fucking hell. This stuff here is toxic enough, and I work with it with the window open or a fan on to dissipate the fumes. And if I'm working with it for longer than, you know, 3 or 4 hours, I have to keep putting the top back on. You know, if I can't sit here with the top off at all. For one, it'll evaporate. Two, the fumes start to get you in your head. There's other chemicals that you use. They're all down there along. That are like that, you know, you got to be careful with chemicals. We do use chemicals in our hobby that are quite dangerous, and they'll mess with your head, they'll destroy your health, so you need to follow safety guidelines when you're using these things, because you're just going to end up a dead fucker, and that's no fun for anybody. So, glue. Now, I recommend the hot glue, which is what To Me Extra Thin is, and this type of glue is what I usually use. Now, this thing that it's sitting in is just a piece of foam, like packing foam, that I cut a hole in and glued a piece of plastic on the back, and I stick my To Me Extra Thin in it, because knocking over your To Me Extra Thin is really annoying, because it's this mat that it's sitting on, it really screws these mats up. It'll also ruin any plastic that happens to be sitting around, so I recommend making one of these things. You can make it out of wood, you can make it out of cardboard, you can make it out of, hell, you can stick it in a, I used to have it stuck in one of these, a big blob of this. It was blue tack for quite a while, but I used the blue tack a lot, so it was kind of annoying. So I made a specific holder for it. So I recommend building a little base to put your glue in to keep you from spilling it. Especially if you're working in a confined workspace, like on a coffee table or a kitchen table and stuff, your wife or girlfriend or mother will not thank you for spilling hot glue all over her dining room table. She will bitch slap you with a flip-flop faster than you can turn your head and say, Mom! You won't know what hit you. I know from experience. Still have the scars. So, hot glue. Highly recommended. And that's pretty much it for building your first kits. You don't really need anything more than that. All right, you can slap together your first kits just from those tools. If you want to get more complicated, more involved, there's another level you can add. So you got your jeweler's files, you got your sanding stick, your hobby knife, tweezers, and hot glue. So the next level, if you want to take it that far, you'll come across this in a lot of instructions for your kits, and that's drill a hole. You'll see a little symbol to drill a hole, and it tells you sometimes in millimeters how big to drill the hole. Well, you're going to need one of these for that. This is called a pin vise. Pin vises, not expensive, the little thing of bits, which I have somewhere over there. You can get these little cases of bits. These things, that was $8. This was $5, I guess. The two of them together, there's enough bits in there to drill your brains out for quite a while. I bought three of these because I break them. Incidentally, I advise that if you're going to buy one of these, buy three of these because you're going to break the little ones quite a lot. So anyway, buy a couple of these. Now, I say buy a couple of these because they're cheap. What I do is I preload a couple of bits, and I'll have like a 0.3, a 0.5, a 0.7, stuff like that, and I'll have an assortment. And different pin vices, so that I always have them, and I don't have to sit there unscrewing the chuck all the time. I mean, they're not expensive, so you know, you can buy all the same kind. The reason why I bought them in different ones is so I know which one is which. And I bought them over, like, I didn't buy them all at once. I bought them over a bunch of years, right? So you know, a pin vise. You know, it doesn't have to be a good quality one. You know, you can get cheap ones. So a pin vise, because you're going to every once in a while be required to drill a hole, right? Another thing to have, pretty handy. Another somewhat advanced tool, a handheld razor saw. This is one of the small ones. It has replaceable razor blade type blades on it. Basically, you unscrew these two screws, and the blade comes out because you break them. This one's actually, back one here is broken. I broke this one a while ago, but this side's still good. You can get them with two different size teeth, or you can get them with the same, right? They come in different blades. Where did I get this? CMKKits.com. That's where I got that. And I didn't get that long ago, so I know they're still in business. But these things are pretty generic. You can get them anywhere. So is this wooden handle. These things are pretty generic, too. Right? So that's a razor saw. This is also a razor saw. This is a big fuck-off bamboo cutting one. Right? This is actually not really meant for hobbies, but we use it in the hobby one. You can get a little miter box to go with it and everything like that. This is meant for cutting bamboo, but we use it in the hobby all the time. We call it a hobby razor saw. That's actually not. So that's another one. All right. So these are both razor saws. These are the next level of tool. Chances are you're not going to use that thing very often unless you're doing diorama work and stuff like that. Or you're like cutting ship hulls in half and stuff like that. That's pretty advanced stuff. And big stuff. Not very often you're going to use something like that. I use mine fairly often, but I use this all the time. This is a pretty handy tool. Right? So this is like next level, you know, level two, we'll call it, level two modeling. Right? Another important tool, this is actually level one, ruler. Now, I don't recommend metal ones, not cheap-ass plastic ones like this one. Just ignore that. Metal ones. These are really, really useful. And don't get ones that have the zero hash mark for the centimeters and inches and stuff like that, that start just in from the edge. If you notice, you might be able to see it on here, zero is the edge here. On some rulers, actually I have one here. On some rulers, like on this one, this piece of crap, you'll notice the first line where the zero is not at the edge of the ruler. I hate that. That drives me nuts and it's useless to me. Right? I need the zero to be at the edge of the ruler in order for these lines here to be useful to me. I need that to be the edge of the ruler. That's why I got these. So zero is actually this corner. Right? It makes it easier for me to cut edges and make sure they're the right measurement and stuff like that. Not like I measure a lot of stuff, but I'm not very good at measuring stuff. So anyway, so that, the metal ruler, you know, a decent one. I mean, this was $7 or $8, right? And like they came in a set, so they're not enormously expensive. So a ruler, handy tool, right? Not exactly next level, though. That's like level one. So we'll put that over there. Another useful tool that I've always found useful, anyway, it's called a chisel. These things are good for scraping off certain kinds of detail. All right, these things are micro chisels. All right, I got these from Micromark down in the United States, but you can get them in all manner of different shapes and sizes and expenses. These things were, I think, were $12 for a set of 10 or a set of 7, I think. I can't remember how many there are. There are 7. So I have 7 chisels, and they were about $1 a piece, I guess, right? And they're very, very useful. I use these a lot. I don't always use them as chisels. Sometimes I use them to spread putty. That's why there's putty on them. So they're actually useful for that too, because they don't react to the putties and stuff like that. So I tend to use them for stuff like that. These are actually in need of replacement. They're kind of worn down. There's a couple here I can see. They're already kind of a little bit screwed. They're not true anymore. In other words, if I tried to scrape something off, it would just make a mess of it. So decent chisels. Steel ones are good, but if you can get them in titanium, they last longer, you know, better quality. So that's pretty much, you know, well, maybe one more. Now, if you're into aircraft and stuff like that, you're going to need something like this. These are riveting tools and panel line tools, all right? So this, if you're into aircraft stuff, this is kind of second level stuff, I guess. Now, I'm not an aircraft guy, right? I'm more armor than anything else. I have built aircraft before, which is why I have these tools, and I do use these when I'm doing it. This thing is for doing rivets. All right, if you're replacing rivets in or adding rivet detail to an aircraft that's missing it, or you've erased it because you were sanding it away, you'll need a tool to add it back in. This thing comes with an assortment of wheels to add different kinds of rivet patterns, different widths of the rivets and stuff like that. It's a pretty handy tool. I've used it many times. It works. It does its job. There are better tools, but this one is really, really cheap. So, and I recommend it because it does its job. But again, there are better ones out there. A friend of mine, Nigel Wells, has recommended me one, and I'm looking around for the note that I have. JB Tools, I think it's. Can't remember what it's called now, but I have it written down. I've been meaning to get it. It's on my wish list for quite a while now. I just never got around to getting it. It's a far superior tool to this, but I just never got around to getting it because I don't have a great deal of need to do rivets. But if I ever did, I'd upgrade. But this is a great starter tool for doing rivets. This is also for rivets. This is more of a general purpose thing. You can use it for aircraft, you can use it for armor, you can use it for anything. I use this thing more for doing nails and wood when I'm doing dioramas than I do for rivets. But it's basically an awl that has all of these different tips little cups cut into them for doing different kinds of rivets, right? It's actually a really, really useful tool made by UMM USA. Well, that's where I got it from. I don't know if they make it. And it was reasonably cheap, about $25, I think. I think they're a lot more money now. But this is an extremely useful tool. I use this quite a lot. Now, this is a dental tool. Your dentist uses these things on your teeth. That's where I got this one. I have a whole drawer full of these things. These things are really good for doing what this does and what this does. This thing, you can use it to do panel lines, and you can use it to make rivets if that's what you want it to do. It doesn't do rivets as well, but if the rivets are really, really small, you can do it with this. If you're in a pinch and you're in a place where you can't get any other tool, this thing here makes up the difference. So dental tools are really, really handy for lots of different reasons. having a drawer full of old dental tools. You can ask your dentist. That's where I got mine. I asked him, you know, what do you do with your dental tools? What do you mean? Well, I could use them for my hobby stuff. And he just gave me this great big bag of old tools. He was just going to throw them away. So I was happy to take them. So just ask him. You never know. He may have them. This is for doing panel lines. It's an extremely handy little tool. I have another one around here somewhere. I'd be damned if I know where it is. I haven't used it in really long. There it is. This one here. This one here is a cheap one. Also made by Trumpeter. It's for doing panel lines, right? I use this actually quite a lot for doing other things other than panel lines. But it's pretty useful, and it does its job, right? It's a bit more difficult to control than this one, but it does its job really, really well. This is also a riveting tool. This one, it comes from UMM USA. This one's actually made by them. It's got their stamp on it, right? So, you know, it's got the hook end for doing one kind of panel line, and then it's got this long bladed end for doing another kind of panel line. So I found this pretty useful, too. So this is a bit more specialized and more expensive. It's like an upgrade. Like I was talking about the upgrade for this tool. Well, this is the first level. This would be the upgrade, right? So those are, again, another example of second level of tools. Those are, you know, if you're decided you were going to stick with the hobby, these are things that I would probably recommend you think about getting, right? If you're just going to be trying things out, it's just these. Maybe not even the jeweler's files, but you may already have some in your garage, right? But, you know, hobby knife, tweezers, sanding sticks, and glue, right? Basics. If you're going to stick with it, add jeweler's files and these. If you really want to take it seriously, well, that's a whole different thing. And I might save that for the next video. But to get things started, that's all you need. So hopefully this video was useful for that. My next video, we're going to talk about a bit more advanced tools. I don't think it's going to be that long because I don't have a lot of advanced tools because I'm not that heavy into it. I don't have like the bench press and micro stuff and everything, but I can talk about them. So anyway, that's all I got for now. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.